sure to share with the rest of the board. Prefer people not handing statements to others to finish their meeting. It is not in keeping with the policy and unfair to those who have kept to the policy limit. Speaker to be made aware when they have 30 seconds to wait. So is there anyone who would like to make a public comment tonight?
Hi, my name is Lori Sparble, 1330, Cleveland Avenue.
Sorry.
I'm here tonight on behalf of the Spark Pride fundraising committee, and I have some current numbers to share with you regarding our fundraising efforts. As of today, we have deposited $226,185 with the school district to pay for the fence project. Our Buy a Brick program is ongoing and runs until November 15th. Today, we have orders for 115 bricks and have collected $18,245. Regarding the total number of donors to date, we have the following approximate numbers. 81 brick purchasers and 69 pillar and other donors. Some of the pillars do have multiple donors. So the total number is 150 to date. So in summary, we have collected $244,430, representing pillar donations, other donations, and brick sales. We also have a donor who's donating all the bricks for the pillars, as well as the bike stick for the seat. We'd like to thank all the donors that have already contributed for the seat.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I was wondering about the money that they collected so far in 2021. Is that ended up money going back to what the school district already spent on this project, or is this money going forward?
Ken Snyder, Edgedale Court. Again, I'd like to offer some comment on the Spark and Pride project. Pride is the operative word that we're confronted with here. You should all be proud and shoulder the responsibility for what you've been able to accomplish over these last several years and your perseverance in bringing this to a final conclusion. Note the community is 100% behind you, or strongly behind you, I should say, solid, because they demonstrated that not only financially and vocally, but in the election of last year, as a matter of fact. Be proud to know that in the journey of life, when given the opportunity to be right or to be kind, it's more important sometimes to be kind than to be classified as being totally right. It's not experience until you've experienced it. In my professional capacity, I'm a spice man. I speak about seasons and the salad of life. That's one of my seasons, but it's not experience until you've experienced it. This has been one heck of an experience, as we all know. The lesson to be learned from this is it can leave a big scar in this community, but I hope it does. I hope that we take the energy that went into this and the experience that we've got, we take the learnings from that and focus on that and keep Wyomissing Area School District as the best of the best. And what people are looking for and envious of what we have the opportunity to do is strive to bring their children over to us. As you go through life, you drive out of the leadership about the rear view here. Oh, you gotta check the rear view mirror right now and make sure you're still in kind of the lane that you'd like to be and you're focused on the future. But the hope that I've got for you is that we all get together and decide that we're driving this place into the future with a common mission and a common focus along the way. I commend you for your support and your services, support you in what you're doing for the Wyomissing Area School District, and more importantly, I trust that every one of you on the board can work to be kind and aligned as to what you do in the future. We're proud of you and welcome. We'd like to be a part of this and move forward. Thank you.
Thank you.
Kim Jen, Old Mill Road. I agree with the man that you guys have the goal of repairing this community. And Julie Vicente has told me that that is one of the district's goals, so that's great. But my question is, how do you plan on doing that? You know, it's one thing to have it on paper. It's another thing to have a town hall or something. I don't know what this is. I thought that this was the lawyer. All of a sudden, it's quasi-town hall kind of thing. There are a lot of things that went down, and most of you weren't at the meetings. For instance, the meeting at damaging things. The meeting at the borough council when a sitting school board member who's behind me said, your petition doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. And you know what? I learned here in Jerry Kozlov's classroom that petitions are how you best communicate your feelings to government. And then that same person signed a much smaller petition that I guess they thought would matter to the borough council. That's one. I mean, that's one example of so many damaging, terrible things that happened that not everyone was there to see. And I know that some of you were there. I think Sandy Reese was there. But most of you weren't at even the zoning hearing. So a lot of damaging things has happened. And instead of having a fluff goal, you should probably activate that. And the other really damaging thing that I'm hearing perpetuated is by the man who just spoke to me before. It's the community. It's not 100% behind this. You have 150 donors. That's like 0.12% of the community. We have 1,000 signers on a petition. That's 10%. So, you know, really think about this, about how you're going to repair the community. I hope you will build this fence so that you can move on and focus on other things. I came before you all, told you about my special interest group, which was to improve school security. Something I've been meeting with administrators about for 3 years, along with several other parents and grandparents. And we have important, wealthy people in that group too who would have happily written checks. But we were kind of, I mean, I came here before you, and so did Amy Combs come before you and talk to you about it. I asked you to call me and contact me so I could talk to you in detail beyond 3 minutes. And not one of you contacted me. And you have kids in school. Don't you want to know what's going on with the school security, what we've accomplished in 3 minutes? So something I think about is, I guess my group, my school security group, doesn't have the weight or the importance that your friends back here for the fence do. So one special interest group, 150 donors, my little group of people caring about school security, one bulletproof glass. You know, I guess we don't have the weight. You picked one special interest group. You could have just dealt with both of us. We could have done these projects together. We could have bulletproof glass and a fence. But I hope people take seriously that there's a lot more going on in this community besides the fence, and not everyone's behind it, and people still very much upset about how this was handled. Thank you.
Discourse and disagreement about the fence has passed. The court has ruled, and it's my understanding the highest court has ruled, the fence may be built. All that is left for us, or for you, is to choose the bid that best serves the job. Yet the conflict continues. Some have said, and perhaps rightfully, that money spent on legal fees around this subject was wasted or spent inappropriately. Yet others could also say that no one expected that a school erecting a fence on their property enclosing a field would be so controversial. So here we are today. The money is raised. The bids are in hand. We're ready to go. But let's stop the fence again, it seems. As parents, we are often tasked with teaching our children life's lessons. Sometimes we show them through our own actions. So what's our lesson here, I'm wondering? Fight for what you believe in. It's a good lesson. Both sides of this issue feel that that's what they're doing. It's a good lesson, and it's an easy one if you prevail. But what happens when you don't? Right now, those who feel they lost, and they say lost, need to consider the lesson at hand. Consider what our kids are seeing and hearing from us and within their own community. It's time to show them, show our kids, all of our kids, and our community, and all the surrounding communities that think that this has gone on long enough. This fence should not forever divide this school, this district, and this community. This fence will be built. Will it be a constant sore spot, or can it be a source of pride? I think today we need to have this be the beginning of the mending of the fences, To continue to delay and disrupt the fence when it will ultimately be built is negatively affecting our schools. The time and energy expended comes at a cost, and I will not accept that cost anymore. The court has ruled, the money has been raised, it's time to build the fence.
Can't hear you.
It's not about the fence for me. This is a trust issue. And when I've been looking through this, it really comes down to trusting this board and doing what's right for the taxpayer. So when I talk about this issue, I'm going to hope that you listen to the issue and not just discard it as, oh, we're talking about the donors again, because that's not what I want to hear. I really don't care about who they are. When I brought up the donor fee, it was never an issue for me until I realized it was being concealed from someone or another. If there's nothing to hide, then don't hide it. As if I have 27 of the 41 names on donor sheets, nameless sheets, many of the forms selected no, or do not wish to be anonymous. Why redact the forms when this is clearly not what the donor wished? Earlier this year, I had a conversation with admin, and they stated the district does not know these names, and therefore can't provide them. And I don't understand that because I also have a check register where personal checks were deposited with the district account from each donor. So the district does know who the names are. Last week, I requested all the donor checks who said they do not want to be anonymous. And even though this would be a 5-minute record rule, it was delayed 30 days to pay the solicitor to find a reason for denying. Is this a good use of district funds for every single right to know as the ones listed in the agenda tonight were denied? You did not know that, but they were all denied. So last Monday, Sandy Reese openly assured us there were no conflicts on this. In an attempt to withhold this from Terry Taylor, fellow board member, it's clear that Reese knows names and is withholding them from Taylor and others. What does this all mean? The bottom line here for this board to understand is it's a prime example of why most residents don't trust the thing you say. Nothing is clear. Most statements are found in some shape of falsehood eventually. You say the words transparent, and at the same time you're concealing public records. At the same time you're holding forum via email and positioning yourself against other board members. This public needs to know that this is the board that's sitting in front of them tonight. Tonight's vote on the stadium is an important one. It has nothing to do with the fence. With all the questions surrounding legality and ethical operations of this project, by voting yes and allowing this to pass, you're telling this community of approximately 14,000 residents that you are not to be trusted as elected officials. Your credibility will be forever tainted. You will forever be tied to a project that probably you seem to have no control over. A project that hemorrhaged district money behind closed doors. Will the public watch as you voted and were controlled by behind-the-scenes puppet masters? Is that how you want to be viewed and remembered by this community? Because it will happen if you vote yes tonight. Thank you.
Secondarily, I want to say, having been a resident since 2000 and following school district matters for the most part when I was on board, I do believe that the community does trust you. I don't think that there's really an issue with that. So I just want to kind of share this with you because I think many in this room would agree also. I am truly hoping that there is healing that comes from this, and along with that healing, I really hope that we can sort of allow our administrators and our school board to get back to the business of running the school district and keeping our school district at a high level that's not in the app. Also wanted to thank all the support that we've had throughout these years to try to make this project go forward. And of the people here, if you, you know, anybody would want to just, if you could raise your hands and just if you're in support of the school district and support the next project, just to kind of show. So there's a lot of people here, aside from, you know, counting $150. Not everybody has gotten their money in yet. Not everybody who's a supporter is also a donor. So I just wanted to share that there is a lot of support in the community. But also to say, like, you know, and I can speak personally for many that I know that we want there to be healing and mending now. And I extend myself personally to anybody who would like to talk to me and try to see if we can make things work better. Many of you who, you know, have not met me and have judgments about me, but you haven't met me, so I'm happy to meet you and sit and have coffee and see what we can do, because we should all work together and make this event for the year. And I hope we can do that going forward. Thank you.
I also had absolutely no intention to get up and say anything. I was on the school board when we first started this project, and I was very glad to leave the school board. So I never thought I'd get up and say anything here again. But I have to comment because I know the attacks I was under, and I know the attacks all of you have been under. And I want you to know from the bottom of my heart that I appreciate everything and every single minute and every single meeting that, and all the time you give up with your own families to take care of all the children in our school district. I trust you implicitly, and I know that we left the school board in good hands when I left 2 years ago.
Legal representation, and one of the questions is basically, hey, what are your other school district plans here? Our firm represents 22 school districts or VOTECs in 6 different counties. We have one board, Owen J. Robbins School District in Chester County, that has us come to every monthly board meeting. Most of the others don't. Transition when we get a new client, we often attend at the beginning of that relationship to build that. But for the most part, most of our longstanding clients do not attend the meetings on a regular basis. As we've told you in the past, and we tell all our clients, we would be more than happy to attend meetings or executive sessions upon request. I think we've demonstrated that. Second question is, if Wyo wanted us to attend every school board meeting, what would it cost? If you wanted us to do that, we can talk about what the cost would be. Third question dealt with the nature of communications between our firm and your school district or this school district in general. I'm the one attorney in my office that does school law ever since that. I don't work with any other clients, or it's fairly rare. And so, you know, I spend a fair amount of my time on the telephone with clients or emails. Sometimes there's more formal written communications, letters, and face-to-face meetings. So those are the means by which we communicate with our clients. The method of communication and who I speak to depends upon the issue. So we have board members who are on negotiation committee. I may speak to them or copy them on emails when it relates to negotiations for a union contract. I may have questions from Julie or Mark on various things on that. So, and there are times that I'll prepare something for a client and it will be sent up to the full board. So it really depends upon the issue and who the point person is on that. And at the end of the day, if I provide a written communication or one of my partners provides a written communication for a while, it's really up to the district to decide how they want that circulated. You know, you're the client, and if Jeff Litz writes an email to the superintendent and the superintendent shares with the entire school board, I'm perfectly fine. That's your call to make on how you share those communications because you're the client. There was also a question about executive sessions and communications and how we keep track of that, and try my best to do that. As many of you know, under the Sunshine Act, it is permissible for a school board or other local governmental bodies to have executive sessions for certain reasons. And it's delineating the law what you can do that for. Usually, it's a gross generalization, but that's because there's some privilege or confidential or other sensitive information that's being discussed. It could be a student matter, it could be a personnel matter, things like that, labor negotiations. And so, for the reasons of that, that's why they're permitted to be held privately. With regards to keeping minutes, there's no requirement in the Sunshine Act to keep minutes of executive sessions. We don't encourage that because, again, the purpose of the executive session is for the board members to deliberate or share information or receive information. Any final decision that the board wishes to make out of it, you know, whether we ratify the union contract, whether we move forward to hire this candidate, things like that, that would be on an agenda at a public meeting with your firm. So I'm hoping that's responsive to the question. But generally, we don't have minutes. There is several questions also dealing with donations by current board members. The first question, is there any legal restriction placed upon board members for making donations to the school district that they serve or to organizations that support those school districts? PTAs, Education Foundation, simple answer to that question is no. No legal prohibition against that. There was a follow-up question, would there that answer change if the school board member was donating the fund for the quote fence project? Same answer, no. There's no legal prohibition against that. There is, within state law, and in some cases federal law, provision of conflict of interest. There were several questions that board members asked about conflict of interest. I'm not going to read verbatim what I have on here, but generally, there's three areas that affect school board members in the performance of their duties dealing with conflict of interest. One is the school code itself. You can't vote for most of your relatives for jobs, gross generalization, but that's one. And you can't do business with the district that you serve. So if you own a company and you sold photocopiers, and you said, well, gee, I'd love to sell photocopies to Wyomissing, there's a prohibition on that unless you could otherwise comply with the Ethics Act. Similarly, the Ethics Act has prohibitions against that or conflict of interest, that you can't do business with the district unless you go through an open and public process, and I have that laid out there. And additionally, you can't do business with immediate family members' businesses or immediate family members. So you can't do business with your spouse or children, things like that, or businesses for which they're associated with if there's some type of pecuniary benefit. So there's a whole series of law on the Ethics Act, and that's another area on that. And then there is also a conflict of interest provision dealing with Act 195 and the Public Employee Relations Act. If there are board members that maybe work in public education as teachers, the like, in other districts, there is conflict of interest provisions that preclude them from serving on negotiation committees. So that's generally conflict of interest under Act 195. So when I hear a question about conflict of interest, those are the type of things I'm jumping to under state law that would typically come into play. And again, that's really not at the heart of the donations that we have here. There was a series of questions about the fence project or the tennis course project, which I have laid out here. And I tried to summarize these, but generally, the gist of the questions as I understood them is, do any of the prior school board motions that were adopted primarily in 2003 that were approved in the past, does that prohibit the current board from making modifications or changes in the direction of the French, the defense project or the tennis court project? Now, the simple answer is no. While the current board needs to be cognizant of what prior boards have committed themselves to do in the past, those previous motions are irrevocable. It doesn't prevent the board from forever being barred from revisiting that issue, and therefore the current board can make changes. Let me give you an example of that. 2003, in December, there was a motion to move forward with the project. Hypothetically, if the board says we don't want to move forward with the project, you don't have to. Or hypothetically, if you want to move with the entirety of the project, you can. Or hypothetically, if you want to move forward with a portion of the project, you can. It's not an irrevocable, you can't change the course of that thing. That being said, going to the next question, the authorization that was adopted by motion in December of 2013 did talk about the stadium fence and the tennis courts and other pieces, and it referred to it as a single project. And if the school board wishes to change that expectation, it can adopt a new motion that authorizes that to proceed accordingly. There was another question about whether the fence project and the tennis court project be paid exclusively through capital funds. And again, I go back to the answer I just gave. That's, there may have been an expectation in the past. If the board wants to go in a different direction, they can simply decide to do so and adopt a motion consistent with it. There was a question about fundraising, and specifically about whether board members may and administrators may meet privately with community members to discuss fundraising for the project. Again, the simple answer to the question is yes, so long as they're not violating the requirements of the Sunshine. And again, I'm not going to go through all of this, but I did put in there for the benefit of the board members generally what the Sunshine Act requires. The relevant piece is this. The Sunshine Act has a very specific definition of meeting. A meeting is a prearranged gathering or form of the agency or subcommittee thereof for purposes of deliberating on agency business or taking official action. What does that mean? It means as a board, if there's a quorum, if it's a full board, that would be fine. And as a prearranged gathering, you talk shop. That's a meeting. And then typically that should be held in public. If you have something less than a quorum, so if two board members and an administrator were sitting down to talk with someone who may be opposed or in favor of the fence project, they could do that. That's not a violation of the Sunshine Act because that's not a meeting under that. So when people ask about private meetings, again, you have to put it within the context of the statute that's applicable to you guys and whether or not it's a meeting under the Sunshine Act. And then I have that here for the rest of the benefit of the board. What are the other requirements of the Sunshine Act about minutes and advertising and opportunity for public comment and announcing executive sessions? There was also a question with regards to the Spartan Pride Stadium project authorization in December of 2013 with regards to a donor-funded project. The motion that was adopted did contemplate that if there are components of the project that would be paid for through the capital fund, that the board would need to be satisfied that adequate funding for those costs had been and or pledged. So again, that was an expectation. There's been some comments earlier that they have been met. The school board is then tasked with making that determination. So you have to be satisfied with that. And again, current school board can stay with that commitment, or if they want to depart from that commitment, that's their call to make, as long as the appropriate motion is made, they can do so. There was a question about accounts for fundraising. generally speaking, this, and Mr. Boyer may want to jump in on some of this. As far as the receipt of funds, the district were to receive funds, you know, private donations for any purposes, or any of our purpose, like defense or tennis courts, that would be given to the business office. They would be responsible for setting up the appropriate account. Presumably, it would be a capital reserve fund or account that would do that. If there are private individuals or organizations or entities that are raising monies, they're responsible for maintaining those funds until such time as they're transmitted to the district. Is there anything you want to add on the funds, just the district?
Sure. I'll speak currently on that. So right now, there's no special fund set up at all, nor there was a special checking account created. Right now, the funds are being held by the district office. They will now be deposited into our general fund checking account once the actual project gets started. And we start incurring bills from the vendor at that point. We'll probably move the project to the capital reserve account. So the funds will be transferred as a separate checking account. Those funds will be transferred to the checking account. Bills will be paid out of the capital reserve.
So again, as far as establishing those accounts, Mr. Ford spoke to that. There was a question about bulk mailing permits. I will be totally honest. I consider myself an education law lawyer. I am not an expert or familiar with the U.S. Postal regulations, and I did not assume that you guys wished me to research them. That being said, I did do some quick and dirty research as to bulk mailing permits. To the extent the district has its own bulk mailing permit, you know, it could, you know, send out mailings that are consistent with its purpose. Again, I don't know what this question precisely is referring to, what was mailed out. I was told it was some forms with regards to allowing people to submit donations to the district, and assuming that's the case, I think that would fall within the parameters of the district mailing permit, since it was the beneficiary. I don't know if there's anything else we need to talk about on that. There was also some questions with regards to the appointment and or the payment of special counsel Mark Kaplan, who represented the school district in the appeals from the zoning hearing board decision regarding the fence. First question being, did the school board violate any laws or policies when it voted to retain Attorney Kaplan due to influence of community members? My understanding is that appointment was done at a public meeting in the Sunshine, so therefore it complied with the Sunshine Act in the school code. I'm not personally aware of any factual circumstances that school board members who voted on that had any conflict of interest, as I talked about earlier, or under the Ethics Act more particularly, that would have created any legal impediment from them voting on that. So I'm not aware of any violations of law or policy with regards to that. There was also a question with regards to the payment of Mr. Kaplan's fees. The question suggested or stated that was it appropriate for the board to pay for the remainder of Mr. Kaplan's outstanding fees after any donated fees were exhausted. Again, it's not unlawful, so long as the school board authorizes the payment of fees under the school code, that is a legal expense that they can do so. There were some questions about generally what I'm going to call the right of conduct. And again, I'm trying to capture these. Outside of right to know requests, are board members entitled to receive information, documents, upon request by virtue of the fact that they're in public office with the district? At the outside, I generally just note that, you know, school districts often provide their board members routinely with information to help them fulfill their duties. And whether they're a new board member or a veteran board member, it's not uncommon to be getting a copy of the collective bargaining agreement on the negotiating team. Can you help me understand that? That's all well and good. Routine requests, I think every district administration shares that type of information. In some cases, there may be requests that are beyond routine. You know, they can be very comprehensive in nature, very detailed, very time-consuming. And in those instances, they're not routine. It's really for the school board to decide what's appropriate. In the written decision, I mentioned a case, Engel versus Bangor Area School District, It's a common court decision, ultimately went up in the Supreme Court. And in that case, it dealt with an individual board member who wished to obtain copies of every single teacher's evaluation of their performance that was in their personnel files. Long story short, it ended up in court. And in that, the Commonwealth Court addressed the issue of an individual board member's right to obtain that type of information. And I have a quote from that decision in there for your benefit, that the public school code confers no authority upon individual school board members to act unilaterally under the guise of carrying out the responsibility of the board as a whole. The law is clear that actions by a school board are to be taken by a collective board, end quote. So, again, generally, depending upon the facts and circumstances, those are critically important. It's really for the board to decide, how much time and effort should be invested in getting information for individual board members. In many cases, we'll say, hey, that's a great idea, go get it. In other cases, they may have some reservations, but really the angle case is the one to do. Outside of that, every board member, just like everyone in this room, has a right to make a right to know request. I'm not in any way trying to suggest that board members should be having to make right to know requests every time they want something, but they do have that right. And if they want to exercise it, they can do so. There was also some questions about donor information and disclosing that and making it public. I'll note at the beginning, the school code expressly authorizes the school district to receive gifts and donations for purposes authorized under the Act. And obviously, facilities are something you're authorized to do, and therefore you can accept donations for that, and you can reject donations. That's your call to make. So it's really, if you accept those donations, it's really, in my mind, the school board, in your discretion, may decide whether or not and how identities of individual donors should be handled. There was a question about disclosing donor information to the public, maybe upon request. What I would share with the board, and this has been stated in some right to know decisions that have been submitted to the district. The law has 30 exceptions. Districts that possess information that is qualifies as a public record. Public records are presumed to be valid, fair game for members of the public. There are 30 exceptions within that law that allow a district to say, we are either not going to provide the document or redact the document because it falls within one of the exceptions of the right to know. In this particular case, there were at least one or two right-to-know requests about some donor information. We cited the exception I'm going to talk about in a second. We redacted donor information, but we otherwise provided the document. That's my recollection. In that law, section 708B13, there is an exception for any records that would, quote, disclose the identity of an individual who lawfully makes a donation to an agency, unless the donation is intended for or restricted for providing remuneration or personal tangible benefit to a named public official or employee of the agency. This exception includes a list of potential donors compiled by an agency to pursue donations, donor profile information, or personally identifiable information releasing to the donor. So, yes, based on that exception in the law that I just read you, the district has taken the position that donor information should be redacted in response to writing our request, and we've cited that exception. I will point out to you, in looking over this the weekend, there is some current litigation in the Commonwealth Court. I cite the case that's being litigated right now about the scope of that exception and what that means. So, when the Commonwealth Court renders its decision, you will have better guidance as to how our courts interpret it. But in the absence of that, I think the statutory exception is pretty clear. Again, there was another question about releasing the donor information. And again, really, that's the board call to make. The board may adopt the motion if they so wish to disclose donor information. I would strongly encourage you, however, before you do something like that, to really consider the facts and circumstances surrounding any donation. Would recommend that you speak with individual donors to make them aware of that intention, to ensure that it's not going to impact their desire. There are some individuals that say, look, I want to remain anonymous because I don't want other people hitting me up for money. Or I really am a modest person and I don't want my name, you know, out there. And to the extent you have some donors that may feel that way, I think this common courtesy and decency suggests that you would talk to those folks before you disclose that. And then, and consistent with that viewpoint, that's why we asserted the exception under the law when we had those requests under the right to know. There's a question that we've, I've thrown in the title accountability. And the question dealt with if a former board member acted in violation of school district policy, what would be the ramifications for the current board as far as accountability? I hate to give the lawyer answer. It does, it depends. You know, depending on the nature of the violation, what's being asserted, what damage was done, there could be a ramification for the district, or it could be relatively de minimis or trivial in nature and have no effect on the district. So, without understanding the facts and circumstances in which the question was raised, I can't provide a more meaningful answer to that. There were some questions about bonding and what are the bonding requirements of the school code. I have the section numbers in Article 4 of the school code that require the board secretary and treasurer to be bonded. That statute also allows, in lieu of a surety bond, a collateral bond, if permitted by the district. There was a question about new board members. And when new board members, can they vote at public meetings? The general rule, newly elected or newly appointed board members are eligible to vote after they're sworn. Take the oath of office, once you've completed the oath of office, you're otherwise eligible, you can then participate in public meetings. Obviously, depending upon when you take the oath of office and the timing of the meeting, you know, that may delay or impact your eligibility. I think the question, referenced two particular meeting dates. I think one was in December, and if I remember correctly, that would have been a reorganization meeting. So there may have been folks who were newly elected, sworn at the reorganization meeting because there was a meeting immediately afterwards. That's why they got to vote on those things, because there were seated board members at that time. If, for example, someone else was appointed at a later date, but the appointment was made at the end of the meeting, obviously weren't sworn board members, and therefore they wouldn't have had the opportunity to vote on things that occur earlier in the day. So it's prospective. After you're sworn in, you can vote. There was also some questions about LRTA. I've given some stuff to the board members in confidence, and I apologize. My server went down in my office around 3 o'clock, so that's why you see some highlights in this document, and there was a couple of corrections that didn't make it in, so I hand wrote some things. There was an issue about whether or not the original LRTA agreement with Wyomissing Square was unlawful for not meeting the requirements of the statute. There's an agreement in principle to resolve that litigation, that's all I'll say, as far as publicly, and it wouldn't affect anything with regards to the original donation in that LRTA agreement. There was a question also under more general terms about emails and forwarding emails to other people that are received in school district accounts. And again, I apologize, this got cut off in the question, but that's the question. Again, without knowing the facts and circumstances, I can't answer the question if there's a hard and fast prohibition against forwarding emails or not. But in some cases, as board members, you will receive emails that contain privileged or confidential information, and that information may be protected by state or federal law, and so disclosure of those emails, that would be improper. In other cases, you may get a totally innocent email. For example, if the school board president receives an email from someone, another public official, thanking the district's participation in the joint event, and the board president wants to share that email publicly to say, hey, you know, the mayor or the borough council sent us a very nice email, and I want to pass all my thanks to them as well. I don't see a problem with that. We're not releasing confidences or privileged information, so it is going to depend upon the facts and circumstances. There was a question about what does the term board-driven initiative mean? Without knowing the context or circumstance in which that term is being used, I can't answer that question. There was another question, if the school board member is intimately involved with an outside group, it might be a PTA, it might be a booster club, you know, maybe, you know, some other type of organization works for kids. Is there a conflict of interest when voting? If that vote might somehow potentially benefit that group, and again, I refer you back to question 7. Is there a conflict of interest? And again, we have to look under that law, and I've had occasions where clients have asked me those things, and we've expressed an opinion on that. There was another question about community feelings. I guess it may also be reflective of some comments you heard earlier, and what weight, if any, should be given to public comment. I know every school board I work with, all 22 of them, take into account community sentiments when they make decisions. At the end of the day, though, from a purely legal perspective, I'm not trying to, shortplay community involvement, if a board decides to go in a different direction, that's not a violation of law. I mean, they have ramifications about how the community feels or things like that, but it's not illegal. And I cited the Thompson case. In that case, dealt with the school district of Pittsburgh closed a number of schools under the school code, and the community was very opposed to the closure of some of those schools, and so they tried to argue this is against the sentiment of the community, and I just provide you a quote that federal court put in its opinion, since the board ultimately went forward with the closure of the schools, and that was against many of the community's personal views. There was also some questions we received about how does the stadium project align with the strategic plan, and specifically I think there was references to Policy 11, Standards of Effective School Governance. Again, from my perspective, the strategic plan is a very specific term of art. It's found in Article 11 of the State Board of Education regulations, and I have it delineated here. As a board, you need to have strategic plans at various points in time that you need to adopt. But they deal with educational programs. They don't deal with facilities. So it deals with the things I have listed here. And so therefore, it has nothing to do with the strategic plans that you're obligated by law to maintain. Those deal with teacher education, induction programs, support services, special ed, gifted ed. Again, there's no requirement to have a strategic plan under State Board of Education regulations with regards to facilities. And then there were some questions with regard specifically to Policy 11 and Standards of Effective School Governance and how this may interplay with some of the issues that the board may address with regards to this project. And again, respectfully, I think there are some very thoughtful questions. But again, my reading of the policy is that policy is not intended to address how a board makes a decision on this issue or any other particular issue. I think it points out some ideals or best practices, the manner in which governance is to be conducted. I don't think it's to be an impediment, though, for a board to vote on a particular item or any of the items that you have on your agenda this evening. And so I would certainly share those comments in response to those questions. So unless I'm missing anything, I believe I went through all the questions that I have.
And non-emergency needs. So the question that was requested was asking if whether using e-alert regarding a fundraiser on the school's emergency alert system violated the CAN-SPAM Act of 2003. And so the CAN-SPAM Act of 2003 is geared towards commercial electronic mail messages with the primary purpose of commercial advertisement or promotion of commercial products or services. And so it would exempt a transactional relationship messages. So when you think about our e-alert system and when you look specifically at our form, it's an opt-in form, and it specifically says there's a disclaimer on there that reads, technology provides a means to communicate vital information quickly to families in the district. This includes an alert system e-alert, which enables the district to send information by three means, record a telephone message, email, and text messages regarding weather delays, cancellation, event reminders, and absences. The district will also use the system for occasional non-urgent school-related communications if you would like to utilize the service, and if you add your contact information. So understand that we have had those discussions. We are not using the alert system for anything but weather-related situations or emergencies. in policy committee. We discussed this, and so the policy committee has tasked administration to look at other ways to communicate with the community. Because one thing that we've heard from you is that you'd like to hear more from us and communicate better with you as a community. And so we're looking at ways to do that. For example, who would have access to it? How would we advertise? So we're in that process. We'll be discussing that again in committee and hopefully have that system in place for our students. But to answer to the question with that, it's not a violation of the CAN and SPAM Act.
Thank you for coming, Mr. Woods. Appreciate that. It's like the prodigal son coming home. We got quite a reception here. If you come in the future, I don't know if you'll get this much in attendance, but I hope we'll continue that discussion. There seems to be some confusion as to why a few of us asked you to come here. It was to suspend the project until we could get some answers. It certainly wasn't to stop it entirely. No doubt the permit was awarded, probably one of the most expensive permits awarded to date in Wyomissing. More importantly, it was more to have you here to address some persistent concerns in the community that we as a board at this table inherited. And I just think ignoring your concerns doesn't make them go away, and it certainly doesn't allow this community to heal if that's the intention and the hope that we heal. Simply ignoring concerns doesn't make them go away. So thank you for being here. I can clarify a few of the questions that I submitted. Board-driven initiative was stated that this entire Spartan Pride Stadium Fence project did not come from an administrative recommendation. And I was looking for clarification of what the actual term board-driven initiative means and how that then applies to how much money and effort was put into pursuing this project. Back up a little bit and add in a couple of our board policies, specifically in the 900 ranges, that really encourage community involvement via ad hoc committees, community advisory committees. 905 is the citizen advisory committee, how to deal with public when they have a complaint and things like that. So board-driven initiative had to do with that, Mr. Litz. I don't see in record anywhere that this came from administrative recommendation. And so I think that's very concerning to a community who has spent a lot of money on this piece of paper, which says that we can, but doesn't mean that we should. Again, money's permits given, money's raised, but again, questions remain. I'll also state that the question about a school board member circulating an email that they received from a community member, that was in reference to an email sent to a school board member regarding this project, and then it was circulated through the community in terms of a campaign for election. My understanding it was meant to disparage the community member who sent it. That was the circulating email question that you weren't quite sure of. I'm sorry that I didn't clarify that. I know that you state that we didn't violate any laws, but violating policy, policies are in place in terms of community involvement, putting a budget into